Dublin, from time to time. I have one thing I want to correct. We discussed just honestly some points about the finite dimension. I forgot one important hypothesis in what I said, so let me make the statement. I am not prepared, but I want to make the statement precise. So, correction, as you could.
One dimension. But I had in mind GLN or more general case.
But I am sure I forgot to say sprint. So, without that, it's wrong, of course. So the second correction, the last one correction, the second correction I want to make before really going to the second, the next topic, is about the formula for the stress formula. I was too fast and I was not careful enough, so I didn't put the thing in the proper. Well, I was not careful enough. So let me state the thing as they should. So, what I said, I discussed the stress formula in general. If I remember correctly, I discussed vaguely this object, which is what should be the spectral side of the stress formula. One thing I could have written, but I didn't, is that for T large, this is given as with the standard notation I have used, that the truncation operator acting on the first variable of the kernel of the Drake formula. And so it acts on the first variable, but now I put the two variables equal, but still the truncation operator acts first on this, if you want. It's then, and then you put x equal 1. You first act on the x variable, and then you set x equal 1. That's the meaning of that. And you integrate over the space, and this gives you the trace function. So that's the difference between the non-compact case and the compact case. We will see in the next lecture, in the last lecture, the twisted case. I wanted to discuss it, but I spent too much time up to now, so I will discuss it only tomorrow. In the twisted case, the formula is more complicated, but this works from the non-twisted case. I didn't discuss the twisted case until now. Okay, so that's one thing I forgot to write. And what I should have said also is that for the geometric side, so for those who want to understand that completely, this, I will discuss that in my lecture next week in the conference. But I just give you an idea of what's going on. So there is a kind of, it's a different object, it's a different, so it's somehow something which depends only on one variable, on the geometric side. I will give formula, but not now, because we would spend too much time. So there is an expression, and what I said is that for T large, then these two expressions are equal. One has a spectral expression and a geometric expression that are very different, but they turn out to be equal and to give this formula. So, the last thing I want to not correct, but to say in more detail, is that the maybe to state it in a more precise way. So for the geometric side, geometric side expansion. Well, I will make an assumption to make things a little simpler. So assume F is a tensor product of local objects. And usually it's just a sum of such things, a finite sum of such things. It's always up to a finite sum decomposable. And assume that FV has regular support. It's regular support. Also for some V.
You mean support in the set of regular vertices?
So, it's a support on the regular set. Then the formula is a bit, so it's what I explained, but I didn't say it in that way. It was a bit improper. So let me write the formula for the geometric sum of f. Here's the sum over O, small O. O in the set of conjugacy classes, and small O is one conjugacy classes, but since I have regular support, I will have only semi-central elements. Unipotent elements never occur for regular, for non-regular elements. So they are all semi-simple. Only semi-simple. Then you have expression G O of T. And I have written the expression for G O of T, but I will maybe rewrite it. G O of F is the volume. So there is something, I want to make it slightly more precise than before. So with the notation I have, so gamma 0 is really the connected component. Of the sun fiber. Of gamma. So you have to see that for most elements the centralizer will be connected. But it may happen that the centralizer is not connected. So one has to be slightly careful to set that small difficulty. It's not a difficulty, it complicates the notation. So you have this modulo g gamma 0 of AF divided by what I denote by iota gamma. Iota gamma is the index, is g gamma f, the order divided by g gamma 0 of f. Just the order. And times a weighted orbital integral.
Sir, so I don't understand. The E of the general gamma is subgroup of the general gamma.
Yes, it's just a connected component.
But if you take the product, it will be included.
The product of what? You can. Let me write the end and the thing at the end and you will see. So, G of AF divided by g gamma 0 of f of kf.
Ah, this is a very good case, yes.
And f of x minus 1 gamma x times v, say v, depends on gamma and depends on the vacation parameter, yes. So it's a weight. So the point here is that since I have taken the connected component, it's a product of local objects. So if I don't take the local component, the connected component, it's not, obviously, in general, a local product of local objects. So you have to pass to the connected component in order to have reasonable formulas. So that's the. So I have written it essentially as if I was ignoring the difficulty with the connected components. So my formula was a bit loosely speaking incorrect. It was too loosely speaking formulated. Sorry. So now I have to also to rephrase the spectral expansion. So I get it a bit too fast again. So keep the spec is
okay. Excuse me, what is V gamma T of X?
So the weight I explained yesterday. The weight I said that
some weight.
Yeah. V gamma X, roughly speaking. I had a picture in the case of GL3 you have kind of a hexagon, but not necessarily regular, where the point, this point depends on x and d. The point depends on x and d. And in fact, it depends on x, t, and the element in the vacuum. Once you, so you get a kind of hexagon, which depends on all these things. And it's just the volume, v of t is just the area of this hexagon. It's by no means a regular hexagon. So it's a kind of thing that occurs when due to the truncation. So it's due to the truncation for elements that are not elliptic, as I explained yesterday. Okay? So it's essentially the formula I have written yesterday, except I was not careful in writing the GC. So that's one point. And on the spectral side, so the G spec of H, I will not be too careful on the way to discuss what is the set of the equivalence class for ladies of group. And one way to write it is the quotient of the order of the ladies of group. So you take all semi-standard ladies of group. So the conjugacy can be assumed to be semi-standard, which means that they contain fixed minimal Lebesgue group. And you have expression G and D of F. I forgot the key when I explained yesterday. And now I will write it more carefully. And P of F. Well, it's a complicated, rather complicated sum. It's a sum over the automorphic representation that occurs discretely of the Lewis of group M. So this denotes the set of discrete automorphic representations for M. I discussed a bit too fast the distinction between discrete and Cuspidon. The discrete contains the Cuspidon, but it's more general. For GL2, you have a trivial representation or one-dimensional representation that occur discretely, but they are not Cuspidon. So you have to look at this. Then you have a sum over elements in the Weyl group, but not all elements in the Weyl group. The element of the Weyl group of G that normalize M. And okay? So you have S belongs to the value G. You're represented by an element in G of F, which represents the vector, the element of the vector. And you ask that L is a Lewisian group which contains both M and S. So for example, for GL2, consider the case of GL2. A G is a GL2. Then M, you have no choice, either N is G or N is N0, the minimum. So for M is G, you have nothing to discuss. So consider the case N equals N0. Then the S can be either 1 or minus 1. It's either the symmetry or the trivial element. Voilà. Then if S is equal to 1, then L equals N. While it will contain minus 1, and then by minus 1, I mean the element 0, minus 1, 1, 0. That's the element minus 1 in the Venn group, it's represented by this element. WS is that. Okay? And the element containing the diagonal, the Lewisian group containing the diagonal and this anti-diagonal element, then the L equals G. Okay? Is this clear? The Venn group for GL2, just an element, it's just plus or minus, just of order 2. Either you have the identity or you flip. The two entries. If you flip the two entries, this is an element of order 2, okay? So I call it minus 1, but it's represented by this element in the group, okay? Then if you want a Lewisian group that contains the diagonal and this anti-diagonal element, you have no choice. The only possibility is G. So it tells you what is R, generally. So it means that in particular, the L is so chosen that this determinant really is not zero. Which means that you have put exactly what is necessary so that this makes sense. This is not infinite. Now, this is an elementary factor. What is really not elementary is that term, which I didn't discuss carefully enough. So let me just say more carefully, slightly more carefully what is the shape of it, because it will be important in the application. So so the G M sigma S sigma T of F, voilà, it will be integral over A L G. When I write A L G, in the supplement you have a decomposition like this. So this is the orthogonal supplement of A G. Okay? Maybe I forgot to say that. So, or if you prefer the same over H, it's equivalent. So write it as you prefer, but I prefer this slightly more compact notation. So, it's an integral over that, of what? Of a trace, of a complicated object. I will not describe in detail, which depends on the parabolic subgroup S, the parabolic subgroup. M, and it depends on lambda. Didn't try. There is some parameter of the lambda belongs here. Then you have another operator, which is inter-turning operator, but depending on S and small s times s. So it's another way to write it, but at zero times the induced representation, the parabolically induced representation from sigma. So the sigma here, you recall it's a unitary irreducible representation, automorphic representation occurring in the discrete spectrum level. So you build the parabolically induced representation. So it gives you the pi lambda, it's a representation of G. And you take the operator, then you finish with the high lambda. So yesterday I was a bit too fast in writing it, so I didn't give all the details. I was just a bit too fast. So I wanted to write this. So for example, if in the case of GL2, in the case of GL2, those terms with M0, you have two possibilities. Either S is a trivial element, then you have really the L to call it M0, and you really have an integral. Or S is a non-trivial element, we said L equals G, then this space is reduced to zero. We have no integral. We have just a term, this cancels, and you just have the M0 as trace of pi. So it's just the trace of the product of an inner turning operator times at zero, times the induced representation evaluated on f. These are the terms that will show up when treating the automorphic induction. Those are the terms that show up to take care of the automorphic induction. So that's the reason why I insist on the definition here. The other terms with really non-trivial integration, these terms are more complicated. I forgot to put T, independent of parameter T here, I'm sorry, for the T. But they won't give any contribution to what we are interested in. So they are the most complicated terms, but fortunately they just don't play all. Okay. So that was the
So you don't care if you use this assumption to run the global functions?
No, here the
it has nothing to do.
It has nothing to do. Okay. The regularity assumption was simply a way to kill the contribution of unipotent elements. Because unipotent elements give contribution that are up to now not explicit unless for GL2. Mm-hmm. And for GLN already, it seems very difficult. I don't know if it's possible, but at least nobody has succeeded in obtaining explicit formulas for unipotent elements. So that's that. But for the spectral side, no assumption. But to have an equality, you need to have the same assumption on both sides. Okay, so that's the state of life. So you see, even in the case of GL2, you need all these terms. There are not too many, but still there are. So probably. So now I can finally discuss what should have been the subject of my second lecture. So, which is not the second but the fourth. So now I will discuss an apparently completely unrelated subject, which is the Langevin star equation. Just as a word, right? I defined yesterday what the orthomorphic representation is, a global case. For local fields, so it's important to try to treat at the same time local and global fields. So for local fields, it's only smooth, admissible, irreducible representation. So orthomorphic means nothing in the local case. So F for F local. Means and simply admissible. While F global it really means that it means automorphic as a real meaning. Automorphic and global is means that I for all, automorphic representation. via the various parabolic, via parabolic induction. Plus taking in some cases of caution. So when in general one has a hierarchy between cuspidal, between discrete, all this is cuspidal, is modulo the center, discrete modulo the center, ignore the center. And genome. Discrete object, cuspidal objects are discrete, but discrete object may not be cuspidal. So you have that. So you could even say something more, even more precise. You have the tempered object, and you have the general object.
So it means that if you have a parabolic induction in general, and if you assume that the original representation is automorphic, then after the parabolic you gain the automorphic.
Yes, yes,
is
yes.
It small or less obvious?
It's, well, you can think it's obvious, but it's not. I mean, for local fields, it's okay. It's
no,
not just. But for.
It's
trivial. But for local field, you need to. So assume you have a semi-symbol. Then Arishal Ra has defined the concept of temporal presentation. So the proper definition is those that show up in the support of the Planck-Schmidt measure. That's one way. They just show up in the support of the Planck-Schmidt measure. So for example, for SL2, you have this is a complex plane, a complex line, you should say. It's a real plane with a complex structure. So remember, you have a zero here, you have a one here, and you have the symmetry which makes things essentially dual. When you pass from the representation here to here, you get the dual. And here you have the trivial representation and two discrete series, and they are all in the same. So you have to know that the dual space, the space of all admissible representations, can be given a topology, but this topology is not separated. It's not an out of space. So for example, you have a trivial representation in the two discrete series, the two holomorphic discrete series that show up at the same point. Then you have a string with 2 points, and here a finite dimensional representation of dimension 3. Here dimension 1, dimension 3, 5, and so on. Two guys. So what are the on the other side it's by symmetry, it's simply here, for example, the trivial representation is a quotient, while if you go to the other side, the trivial representation is the sum, the dual. Okay, and the discrete series are here sum representation, while you have a quotient. And now, what is the temporal spectrum? The temporal spectrum is this line. So, in fact, because I need two copies. There are two copies. So I forgot to define the second copy. The second copy, but with different representation. The second copy, you have the zero here with two guys that are called limit of discrete series. You come together. Then you have the point 2, so again 2 discrete series, then you have 4, again 2 discrete series, and so on. So, what is the Templer spectrum? The Templer spectrum is this imaginary axis, so it corresponds to unitary parabolic induction, properly normal. Then you have the discrete series and the trivial representation. Not the temporal representation. Not. This is unitary, but not temporal.
Not
temporal. So you have all the discrete series. The discrete series are always temporal. That's what I invented. The discrete series are always temporal. Here also, discrete series are always temporal. Discrete series are always temporal. Here you have again temporal. And what is important if you look at unitary representation. The possible unitary representation for SL2R, I was thinking, and the picture is basically the same for SL2 of local field, except that the line has to be replaced by a circle. And the point here becomes a part of it. You together of this. Okay. Well, it's not strictly, no, it's slightly more complicated, but the picture is almost similar. And what is important is that you have a unit, a family of unitary representation. And here, I see that if you want to count them only once, you have here, up to, from the 0 to the 1, to the parameter 1. So these guys are the so-called complementary cells. They are what? They are paradoxically induced representation that can be endowed with a unitary structure. They can be seen as unitary, but they are not tempered. Those with so here the zero is okay, but up to one somehow it goes up to one. The one belongs to, it's a degenerate form of the complementary cells. So that's the picture. So these guys are not tempered. I should have said that these are limitations. I could have added that.
Well, sorry,
by definition, tempered are unitary, but well, not all unitary are tempered.
Is it correct that this series is a representation with matrix elements which is squared to rainbow modulo center?
That are what?
Square integral.
No, unfortunately not.
So, discrete.
No. So, discrete elements are those for which matrix elements are square integral. Discrete, yes.
Yes.
For discrete, but tempered.
Not in 2, but 2 plus epsilon. Yeah? True.
It's L2 absolute. You're right. In some sense, tempered means L2 is L2.
For some of them.
For all of them.
So it is slightly weaker than.
Yes. They are. So the precise formula I don't want to write. Mm. But one should know that unfortunately, the so called the matrix coefficient of step-up representation are called by Harishchandra rapidly decreasing. But it's a very unfortunate terminology because those rapidly decreasing functions may not be integrable. They may not be in L1. They are in L2 plus epsilon, but not in L1. So it's very bad. The terminology is very unfortunate. So that's the picture. Okay? So for SM2, you have these guys, and the picture is roughly basically the same in the periodic setting. And for example, to say that the representation obeys the Hamiltonian conjecture means that precisely they don't belong to the complementary series. For spherical functions, so the periodic setting is something like that. The set of representations that are for SL2, for example, the set of representations that are in the spherical spectrum is something like that. So the circle replaces the line, but you have the same guy, and again you have the symmetry, so it's seen on the. That does not belong to that part. only unitary parameters are allowed. So this is a this is life. So you see already for SL2 or GL2, it's not completely trivial to classify these objects. In fact, to my taste, one needs first to understand completely GL2 SL2 globally before starting discussing. So, but you need really to compute everything completely. But okay, this takes some time. Okay, so now I can turn to the other part. So you have on one side the automorphic objects, and on the other side you will have what? So we will discuss first the case of G from GL1. So I'll go back to the end of lecture. And what do you have? You have A of GL1. So let me get it in the front here. That way, sorry. I will write this in the other way now. So this one is a sort of hum. Continuous. Homomorphism. Of what? Of WF. Which I will write as GL1. Well, WF. Now is the André Weil. Well, you have a map. I should call the reciprocity map for GL1. And F. So F is local or global. And on the other side, you have the automorphic. And F. I could have added another variable which would make sense, which means that I am looking at the complex automorphic objects, which means representation in complex spaces. And it's of interest to look at other fields. You can look at QL bar representation. So this also makes sense. So if you look at that, this is just a remark. You have the group GL1, so GL1 is here. You have F, F is here, F is here, and you have the complex field, which is here. So, in fact, it's really what happens. So, the whatever local or global, Bernard has explained that this is an isomorphism. This is class field. Okay, so. So now, what else can be said? So I may overlap with your lecture. Marcin, I don't know if I overlap or not. So the second case, so this is classical, just it has been refined by using André Weil, where Benkinen is just a rephrasing of the standard classical theorem. Nothing more, nothing less. Okay, now consider the case I will look at the case of a torus. So now this is already due to Langlands. So the second case, so the first case, G for GL. So the second case I want to discuss, G is a torus over F. The torus is completely described by the set of characters of the torus. X of T. It's just a freezy module. The finite dimension of what is a free module. With a Galois action. So now what is the generalization of that? Of the case here? So when the reciprocity map for T and F, for T and F will be a map from what? So already the object will be a bit slightly more complicated. I will write it this way, H1 admissible. So I'm going to put an A for admissible, or add, if you prefer. Of WF and an object which is called PChange. And what? It will go to topomorphic. Objects, automorphic representation for T, F, and if you want, C. For complex representation. But the point already here, it's slightly more subtle. Here I said it's isomorphism. Well, it's already more complicated. It's an isomorphism.
Again, the torus of the same module, yes?
Hmm?
It is drones or the same? Or
the same?
No.
No?
No. It's a complex. It's over the complex numbers.
Ah, I see.
It's over the complex numbers.
No, no, I
because you hear. So.
So you can compare toroidal composition fields because the group of characters just with the CSS. Both of them is defined on the CDS. And so you can compare them. Right?
If you, a torus can be seen as example, T of F can be seen as X, the set of characters, answer as multiplicative in the local case, yeah, or of course T of A. Oh, sorry, sorry, it's sorry. Sorry, 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 sorry.
It's not that. I'm sorry. Okay. No, no, sorry, I forgot the camera action.
So, sorry. So it's page 0 of Galois and T over F times the set of characters. So I look at the one-dimensional, I look at the co-characters, and so as many people, this is for F. So TA is the same, it's H0 of Galois, K over F. The K is big enough so that the Galois of K bar of the K acts triggering. So you take a large enough Galois rho, and similarly, you take X lower star, and so adapts the index, the multiplicative rho of the depth. So, you have this. Okay? And in fact, it explains you why there is a co-kernel, there is a kernel, a finite kernel. I tell you immediately what the difficulty is. You have to compare TF over T, AF, and the object, which is H0 of Gal T over F, times acting on X over star tensor CF. CF, so this formula makes sense for F local or global. If F is local, this is nothing but this. But if F is global, CF is roughly speaking is across is no, not roughly speaking. A cross F divided by F cross.
What's CF?
So it's a classical notation.
Okay.
You follow the spin of lecture, so it's I recall that CF. Deviation from asset principle. just the deviation from asset ratio.
Sorry, but deviation should be a kernel. It is kernel.
No, no, it's a kernel. It's the those open dimension. So, because you have an exact, an obvious exact sequence. TA over TF is the same as ATA. With a standard notation, one doesn't find the delta from right from F, with T going to H1, T of F bar, or T of K, H1 H0 of F with T of AK, going to that, because this is T of F,
yes.
And this is equal to T of F. Yes. So you have this exact sequence, and this is, you can just model it. So this gives you an injective map here, but it's not surjective, and this
it's
is
the kernel of the corresponding map for the first.
Exactly.